need to move it and say, this is what happened to me and it's awful. But what about missing and murdered indigenous women? I mean, this has been happening in our country for decades. We care more about some victims than we do about others. The two little girls who get shot in a playground in a low-income black neighborhood gets very different news coverage than
a coverage at all.
Deep coverage at all than a young white girl who gets shot and killed, sadly, caught in a crossfire or gang fire. So I think that's on us to ask ourselves, who do we actually care about?
I think that's true. I think it's also, I mean, I hate to cling to hope here, but I don't know what else to do. In a circumstance like this where, like you said, it's so clear that there are different victims are getting different levels of attention, 20 years of negligence has happened, but also, instead of why now, how about why not now? Meaning, thank God we finally have enough momentum where victims have the courage to speak out. I know so many women who have experienced different level of actress me too, especially when I lived in Los Angeles. And I think all of us used to always laugh about it because there was such a defense wall. We were so afraid to speak to each other in a more vulnerable way. And so a lot of us cling to that. And I think now that we've built that there is this snowball effect, and so many people have come forward, that we can actually talk about a third of a lifetime docu series is a sign of a time when we can start speaking.
I hope you're right. It is interesting what you mentioned, though, because there has been this reckoning. The Me Too movement really did start. It started outside of Hollywood, but Hollywood really brought it to the forefront. And now we're living in a time where there's the ruffling of an accusation. People are losing their jobs right away. They are brought into the media, and we'll talk about it, and they're kind of out of the spotlight. And it's quick and it's swift. The music industry, however, has not quite been touched in the same way.
And it's kind of rock and roll.
Rock and roll, that's right, rock and roll. I think there's this assumption a lot of times that, there's an assumption about the female fan base.
Yeah, the groovy logic.
Yeah. Well, they must have been, wanting it, But when you deal with underage sex, and girls who are aspiring to be musicians and the kind of power dynamics that are at play there, not a lot is being looked at there yet. So, I mean, in the terms of hope, I do think that this documentary is sort of shining a light back on. But it can't just shine a light on R. Kelly, although it should shine a light on R. Kelly. There are so many. If you start looking under some rock and roll rocks, you're going to find a lot of growth.
I think that you have to look under rocks. I think that's part of the
They're on top of the rocks.
They're on top of the rocks, and it's part of the culture and the lore of rock and roll. Like, if you think of the classic rock bands, like Jimmy Page very famously had a 14-year-old girlfriend. Like, everybody knows that. And then she